Okay, so topic today is necrotising enterocolitis, and within that I'm going to be talking about the exam topics in NEC, that is epidemiology and pathogenesis, radiological findings, define NEC totalis, clinical presentation, stages of NEC, pathology and diagnosis of NEC, indications for surgery, management and complications, and prevention strategies. So just a short history. NEC was first probably described in 1890, so that was more than 130 years ago. And the first surgical success was in 1943. However, it was the 1960s when the premature babies started living longer with ventilatory support that NEC became clinically important. So 1960s was the era for early operation. 1970s talked about non-surgical management as well as the peritoneal drains. And 1978 was when Bell published a classification system for NEC that still stands good today. So talking about epidemiology, NEC is mainly seen in premature neonates. That's over 90% of the cases are seen in premature neonates. The incidence varies in various countries, and in the US is about 7 to 11% and 3 to 5% reported in Europe. The exact incidence in India is not known. There is an inverse relationship of NEC to the gestational age and birth weight of the baby. So the younger the baby, the more premature the baby, as well as the less birth weight of the baby, means higher risk of NEC and higher mortality with NEC. Also, in the very early premature babies, so you've got a 24-weeker or a 25-weeker, NEC tends to occur later. So what people have generally said is around a corrected gestational age of about 30 to 32 weeks is when the NEC tends to occur. However, if it is a term baby, generally NEC occurs very early, so within the first week of life. More than 95% of babies with NEC have been enterally fed, and formula-fed babies are seen more than breastfed babies. So going on to the pathophysiology of NEC, so some insult which causes a mucosal injury in the bowel, which then leads to bacterial translocation, and this in turn triggers a exaggerated and dysregulated inflammatory response, which then causes the tissue damage and tissue necrosis. So that's the whole point of it. So there is something which causes an ischemic injury or an osmotic injury or an infectious injury, something that causes a mucosal disruption or a mucosal injury, which then leads to bacteria invading or translocating into their bowel wall. And within the bowel wall, there is a dysregulated inflammatory response, and this leads to the actual damage and the tissue necrosis. Okay. So what are the risk factors for NEC? Various factors that cause either perinatal hypoxia, hypothermia, or a decreased umbilical arterial blood flow, or anything that causes a decreased blood flow to the bowel. All of these things are risk factors for NEC. So absent or reversed end diastolic umbilical arterial blood flow, eclampsia, fetal distress, sepsis with premature rupture of membranes, respiratory distress syndrome after birth, periods of apnea, congenital heart disease, persistent ductus arteriosus is another risk factor, either by itself or with the NSAID treatment for the PDA. Exchange umbilical catheterization, exchange transfusion are particularly important because umbilical catheterization can introduce infection into the portal venous system directly, and exchange transfusion causes very massive and rapid changes in the portal vascular volume as such, which can give rise to bowel wall ischemia, bowel wall hypoxia. Feeding schedules have been implicated with either formula feeds being used, high density milk formula being used, or initiating very early enteral feeding in the premature babies, or a very rapid increase in enteral feeding. The role of bacterial infection is not very clear. It's not generally believed that bacterial infection is the initial or is the main cause for NEC. It is usually a part of the pathophysiology where there is some kind of mucosal injury which could be because of other reasons than bacterial infection, but bacteria then play an important role in propagating and increasing the severity of the NEC. So, as regards the pathology, the commonest area for involvement is the ileocecal region. So, a lot more of the ileum and more distal ileum, and then can expand to go more proximally. Colon tends to be more affected in term babies, okay, which again shows that term babies are more likely to have frank blood per rectum because colon is affected more commonly. However, it can involve the entire bowel, that is including both the small bowel and the large bowel, when it is called NEC totalis. The macroscopically, we can have multiple areas of bleeding, flabby bowel, bowel edema, and areas of necrosis, which can have a confluent location in a localized segment of the bowel, or it might be a more generalized bowel involvement with patchy areas affected throughout the bowel. Microscopically, the lesions are characterized by a coagulation necrosis. Again, this points to the role of ischemia, bowel ischemia, within the pathophysiology of NEC. So the lesions also show bacterial overgrowth and inflammation. And depending on the age of the lesions, there might be some reparative changes like granulomas and even fibrosis. One of the characteristic features is called a pneumatosis intestinalis, which basically refers to gas within the bowel wall. And we will talk about it again later on. So this pneumatosis or the intramural gas, this is usually from gas-producing organisms which are within the bowel wall, and that is what causes the pneumatosis. And this pneumatosis may be either submucosal or intermuscular plane. Clinical presentation of these babies in the earliest stage, there's usually just subtle features of sepsis. You don't really know what is the cause of the sepsis, and NEC might be one of the causes. So this is what is again called as a stage 1 NEC, which is probable NEC. So all they have are temperature instability, some lethargy, feed intolerance. So very general kind of symptoms and signs. So it might be an NEC, it might not be an NEC, and there might be some blood in stool along with the arrest. However, the next stage, which is again stage 2, is when we are sure that it is NEC. At this stage, babies have abdominal distension, there may be blood in stool, and the abdominal x-ray may show features of either pneumatosis or portal venous gas. Within this, you've got a more severely affected children and a more mildly affected children. And finally, the advanced stage of NEC shows severe sepsis. So there might be features of hypotension, thrombocytopenia, acidosis, decreased urinary output or renal failure, with gross abdominal distension, tenderness, and there may be free air. So this advanced stage is what is again called as stage 3 NEC. So looking at the actual, the classification of the staging, it's called the modified Bell's staging. And as I was saying, stage 1 is a suspected NEC, stage 2 is the definite NEC, and stage 3 is the advanced NEC. Within each stage, there's an A and a B. So stage 1, where it's suspected, this is just general kind of features, and there might be some mild ileus and a heme-positive stool. Within that, stage 1B means there is obvious blood in stool. Stage 2A is definite NEC, where we know that there is intestinal dilatation, ileus, pneumatosis intestinalis. However, this itself is divided into 2A, which is the babies being mildly ill, and 2B, the babies are moderately ill, where they might have an additional metabolic acidosis and or thrombocytopenia. Okay, stage 3 is the advanced NEC, stage 3A and 3B again. So 3A and 3B, the only difference is that in 3B, there is features of peritonitis or bowel perforation with pneumoperitoneum. without the features of pneumoperitoneum, they are called as stage 3A. So this is a picture of a child in stage 3 NEC. As you can see, this is a tense, shiny abdomen with discoloration of the abdominal wall. The child is needing a urinary output monitoring. There's a ventilator in place. So a very sick child with NEC. One of the mainstays of diagnosis is an X-ray abdomen, which might show non-specific features like bowel dilatation. However, if there is asymmetric bowel dilatation involving any particular segments of the bowel, that's another pointer towards NEC. Presence of pneumatosis intestinalis or portal venous gas again points towards NEC. Bowel wall thickening can be seen, and when there is ischemia of the bowel or there is infarction of the bowel, on serial X-rays it can manifest as a fixed dilated intestinal loop. You should always look for features of pneumoperitoneum, which can be either generalized pneumoperitoneum or some subtle features may be there, which might need either a lateral shoot through to look for free air under the abdominal wall, or if you're going to take a left lateral decubitus position, then air will be outlining the liver under the right costal margin, okay, costal cartilages. I think most of us would know about Wrigler's sign and the football sign. So Wrigler's sign is presence of air on both sides of the bowel wall, and a football sign is the falciform ligament being delineated by air on either side of it. Sometimes though, there might just be a white out to the abdomen, which may be because of ascites secondary to an intestinal perforation. So this is a picture which shows a child with NEC, where we can see that the bowel is dilated, there is bowel wall thickening, and there's features of pneumatosis where you can see some fine air bubbles within the bowel wall, particularly here. And this is features of portal venous gas, which we can see. Ultrasound has now captured a place where it's much more sensitive than just serial abdominal X-rays to both image the bowel loops in cross-section, as well as to dynamically evaluate both the perfusion of the bowel as well as if there's any peristalsis within the bowel. So it can be used to pick up poor intestinal peristalsis earlier, and also to, it's very sensitive for assessing bowel necrosis. So what are the features in ultrasound? Bowel wall thickening again, decreased bowel peristalsis. Then intramural gas can be seen again very sensitively on ultrasound as hyperechoic foci within the bowel wall, and look for free fluid, especially with echogenic debris. So when there's debris within the free fluid, this suggests perforation. The vascular state of the bowel wall can be studied using ultrasound with Doppler, and a hypovascular bowel wall suggests that there is bowel necrosis. So just some pictures to show you what we're talking about in ultrasound. So this is a picture showing a very thickened bowel wall, the bowel wall edema, and here are some pictures showing the hyperechoic bubbles of air, of gas within the portal venous system in the liver. And this is again the hyperechoic little dots which we can see within the bowel wall, suggestive of pneumatosis. And Doppler study looking at bowel perfusion, which might be either increased or hypervascular, suggestive of inflammation of the bowel wall, or hypovascular or avascular bowel, suggestive of necrotic bowel in NEC. So in terms of management of NEC, it's fairly easy for us to write that the child needs supportive neonatal intensive care, including IV fluids, total parenteral nutrition, ventilation, ionotropic support, and blood products as required. However, it is a very tricky situation to manage these babies who are extremely fragile. They need to be managed in the NICU setup with involvement of neonatologists who will be able to manage the intensive care for these babies. serial laboratory investigations, including hematological investigations, to look at the blood counts, to look at coagulation parameters, to look for thrombocytopenia, electrolyte imbalances, acid-base imbalances are all essential. Along with that, abdominal examinations on a regular basis and serial abdominal x-rays can help to pick up early features of either pneumoperitoneum or bowel necrosis. Again, ultrasound has come more and more into play in recent times in the assessment and evaluation of these babies. So in terms of treatment, essential part of the treatment is to give bowel rest. So nil enterally, the time duration varies according to the stage of NEC. So if you go back to the Bell's classification, we find that stage 1 NEC, which is suspected NEC, the babies are kept nil enterally for about 3 days. Where it is definite NEC and the child is not very sick, so it's mildly sick child, 7 days. And for a moderately ill child, we're going on to 10 days. And for an advanced stage, that is a stage 3, they might need to be nil enterally for up to 14 days. Along with that, a good nasogastric decompression to relieve the abdominal pressure from the dilated bowel is required. Broad spectrum parental antibiotics are generally indicated, and we have got to make sure that it covers both gram-negative organisms as well as anaerobes according to the sensitivity pattern and what is the prevailing antibiotic practices within your own particular unit. So when do we go for surgical intervention? See, the only absolute indication for surgery is bowel perforation. Okay, so there are many relative indications. So within that, a child who's clinically deteriorating in spite of maximal medical management, so we're doing everything that we can and the child continues to deteriorate and does not show any particular improvement in status, we've got to think that the child probably has got bowel necrosis and needs to go for surgery. If there are features of peritonitis or abdominal wall redness and erythema, suggesting localized cellulitis or an intra-abdominal abscess formation. Or on serial x-rays, we're finding a fixed intestinal loop for more than 2 days. All these things suggest that there is probably bowel necrosis and that necrotic bowel will need to be removed. There are biochemical indicators of bowel necrosis which may aid in this decision making, and this includes persistently high CRP, persistently low platelet count, and other markers like interleukin, which have been used to help in the decision making in these really sick babies. Of course, another reason for surgical intervention is a late complication of stricture in the bowel. Okay, so the first thing we want to talk about is the insertion of peritoneal drains in children with perforated NEC. This is introduced by Sigmund Ein et al. In 1977, with further reports up to 1990, where they reported very promising results and said that the drain is a definitive treatment in almost one-third of the babies. However, when it was used more and more in the world, they found that it wasn't such a good option in all babies. So we had a series of trials, the NEC STEPS trial and the NET trial, which all showed that between PD and laparotomy, there was no difference in survival, TPN dependence, or length of stay. And in fact, PD was associated with increased risk of death or neurodevelopmental impairment. So, and it was later on found that peritoneal drainage was effective as a definitive treatment in only 11% of babies, and all the others either died or needed a later laparotomy for reason of necrotic bowel. So here's a child who's gone to laparotomy and you're faced with two different scenarios. One is a clear-cut, well-demarcated, healthy bowel, and again a well-demarcated necrotic bowel involved with NEC. And here the treatment becomes quite straightforward, that we resect the necrotic bowel. However, there might be another scenario where we have got a lot of extensive involvement of the bowel and the lesions are not clearly demarcated. Okay, so what do we do in either of these? Surgical options at laparotomy, we have to resect obviously non-viable bowel. We have to clean out the peritoneal cavity. In situations of early NEC where the bowel edges are having questionable viability, or you don't know if the disease is still progressing or not, a stoma is always a safer option. In children who are presenting with later stages or with strictures of bowel, there are clear-cut margins of viability, a primary anastomosis can be attempted. We must avoid resecting bowel of borderline viability because of the risk of shortcut. So these are important principles of surgery. So this is from the IAPS textbook of surgery, where they've talked about focal lesions, multifocal lesions, pan-intestinal lesions and total intestinal gangrene. The total intestinal gangrene is the one where we should be considering withdrawal of treatment. And what we do with these other kind of scenarios, we can consider bowel resection with stomas, as I said, in either focal lesions or even multifocal lesions. And they might need a single resection, or we might need to go for multiple bowel resections. If the child is not very stable, then rather than going for any anastomosis or multiple stomas, we can consider clip and drop. So apply clips to the end of the resected bowel, drop them back into the abdomen, come back in for a second look laparotomy after 24 to 48 hours. In children having pan-intestinal involvement where there's no clear-cut demarcations, it's diverting high jejunostomy may be a better option for decompressing the bowel as compared to a nasogastric tube. And finally, if it is a pan-intestinal gangrene, then a simple open and close may be a safer, maybe a better option, and we can consider withdrawal of treatment. Bowel resection and primary anastomosis should play a very small role in acute instances where the demarcation of the necrotic segment is very clear-cut, and has a bigger role in later stages when patients are presenting with strictures. So what are the complications? We have early complications of sepsis, that's meningitis, intra-abdominal abscess, DIC, coagulopathy, shock, respiratory failure, and then complications of surgery, either a burst abdomen, enterocolic or an enterocutaneous fistula, stoma and TPN related complications, or short bowel from intestinal loss from NEC or from our resections. Late complications include late intestinal strictures and lesions, recurrent NEC in about 8%. About 30% of these babies we are not able to save, particularly the stage 3 babies. 30% mortality from NEC, intestinal failure in 13%, and there's an impaired growth and neurodevelopmental outcome. So it's important for us to consider prevention of NEC, and this is a very busy slide, looks very complicated with a lot of therapeutic interventions that have been studied. But only certain interventions have got a good level of evidence, level 1 evidence to show that these things work. So antenatal corticosteroids have got a small beneficial effect for reducing the risk of NEC. Having a standardized feeding regimen where we are introducing enteral feeds to these preemie babies in a graduated manner again has shown a significant reduction in NEC. Giving the babies breast milk, either donor breast milk or the mother's breast milk, has got very good risk reduction for NEC, and there is very strong evidence for that. Probiotics again may reduce the risk of severe NEC. So even if the baby is going to get NEC, probably they might have a more milder variant than the severe variant. Other preventative and therapeutic interventions have not yet found widespread acceptance. Okay, so this is just a reiteration of the topics that we have discussed within NEC today. And that will help you to recap the presentation. Thank you for your time and attention.